these annual celebration of Constitution Day. For those who don't know me, I'm John Taylor. I'm the Associate Dean for Academic Affairs here at the College of Law. We're very pleased to have you here with us. Here at the law school, we like to think of every day as Constitution Day, but this day is special because, as you know, September 17th is the anniversary of the date at which the original Constitution was signed at the Philadelphia Convention. We can look at this as the 225th anniversary of the Constitution coming into effect in 1789. At age 225, our Constitution is generally regarded as sort of the longest standing national constitution in the world. Now, some of you may remember that a few years ago, the College of Law celebrated its 125th anniversary, and we all had to learn to call it the sesquicentennial. Not easy to say. Repeat after me. Sesquicentennial. Okay, yeah, you've got it, right? Took me a while to get it, right? So you're probably wondering, is there a special word for the 225th anniversary of something? Well, aren't you? Yeah, okay. Well, I, in any event, wondered, and I looked into this, and apparently authorities differ, but the leading candidate seems to be quasquibicentennial. How about that? I'm not even going to ask you to repeat that one. Okay, so without further ado, we have an excellent program for our Constitution's quasquibicentennial. To introduce our speaker, I present to you our Associate Dean for Faculty Research and Development, Anne-Marie Lafazzo.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is a pleasure to be here with my friend Larry Rosenberg and my colleague and friend, John Taylor. Sesquicentennial? Quasquibicentennial. I think I said that better than he did. But anyway. Show of hands, who's cooler, John Taylor or Anne Lafazzo? Anne Lafazzo? John Taylor? What? It shouldn't even be called. Wow, I think I won.
Calculus if we're both in the room, does it not?
Who does not want to vote because they're afraid? Okay. All right, fair enough.
You better call me into the mix.
Okay. We know you're the coolest, Jerry, Professor Ashdown. Okay. Okay. I am going to introduce Mr. Rosenberg today, and I was thinking of first telling you things like, that really is his real hair. I mean, he has really nice hair. Have you seen the picture of him? Nice hair. And it really is his, okay? I mean, all right, that wasn't funny. Okay, I thought that was really funny. Or maybe that when we were in law school together, because we went to law school together, that he spent more money on hair product than his tuition for a semester. That's not funny either? No? All right, that was funny. I got a little bit of that. But I'm not going to do that because this is an important, serious moment. Instead, I'm going to tell you that Larry is, I think, what many of us aspire to be, which is he is not just an excellent lawyer, but he is a great lawyer with great ethics and great presence, and he's known nationally and internationally. He did go to Cornell undergraduate, where he was a debating champion. He then went to Penn Law School, where upon the advice of a mutual friend of ours, who I won't give you his name, not because he's famous or anything, but he might be watching this. He was told that our professor in civil procedure, Stephen Burbank, who's sort of like a cross between Tom Cady and Jerry Ashdown. Okay, put those two things together. Professor Ashdown is confused by that, but it's sort of like a cross between those two people, okay? All right, so imagine, and he's an expert on Rule 13 sanctions and things like that. Have you learned that yet? One else? About rule, we'll learn, about frivolous lawsuits. And I'm probably getting this story wrong, but he said, you know, he really likes when you could debate him. So Larry went home that night, the day before the first day of law school, which is not that long ago for most of you. And he read an article. Are you getting mad at me? Okay. He read an article that Professor Burbank wrote. And remember, Professor Burbank's the expert in the world on Rule 13 or whatever. Rule 11 sanctions, right? Sorry.
The Rules Enabling Act.
Oh, it was the Rules Enabling Act. Sorry, 1789 or something, like 1787, I don't know, whatever. Okay, Rules Enabling Act. And he said to Professor Burbank, I'd like to talk to you about your article. I think it was really well done, but I have a couple suggestions, okay? To which, can you imagine what Professor Burbank decided to do to him in class the next day, okay? I'll let Larry tell that story, okay? But more importantly, Larry graduated coif from Penn Law School. He went on to clerk for a judge on the Third Circuit, who was not a judge on the Third Circuit when she first asked him to clerk. Larry decided in law school to take law school seriously. He became a member of the Law Review, but he also decided he became our moot court champion, which is like your Baker Cup. And then he decided he was going to do the Jessup, and we brought Judge Roth in. And Judge Roth thought he was so impressive, she offered him a job. She said, but I'm not sure whether it's going to be for a trial court, that I'm a district court judge, or I'm going to be a Third Circuit judge. And he said, that's okay. Either way, it turned out she was a Third Circuit judge. And so this just shows the power of just doing well, being professional, being excellent in law school and who you meet, and being genuine, which he is. He's a very genuine person. He went on to go to the Department of Justice and the federal programs, and he excellent program, the honors program, where you learn how to be a very ethical lawyer. You learn how to, you really understand the law. And then he went on to private practice at Jones Day, which is one of the largest firms in the world. And it is a firm that that does very important work throughout the world. But also, if you become a partner, you're fairly well paid. So Larry is fairly well paid. I can attest to the fact that he has a very large house that's also very nice, and I like it a lot. And he also has a very, I know, I'm in so much trouble. He also has a wife that you guys remember, or you don't know, Dean McConnell. But Dean McConnell is one of the most incredible, she's now our provost, incredible people in the world. His wife is a lot like her, just brilliant, beautiful. When she speaks to you, you think you're the only person in the room. This is the person who he has chosen to be his life partner. So you're in for a treat today. He's a great public speaker. He's a good friend. And I give you, please help me welcome Larry Rosenberg.
Well, thank you very much. That's really a wonderful introduction. And Associate Dean LaFosso and I have been good friends for many years. And there are all kinds of law school stories that we won't tell anyone while this is being webcast, but I do appreciate the very kind words and am really thrilled to be here. And as I think some of you know, for the last few years I've been co-teaching a Supreme Court clinic here at WVU with Stephanie Taylor, my colleague from our Jones Day Pittsburgh office, and with Professor LaFosso, and at times with Professor Kreck as well. And it's really been a wonderful pleasure to do that. I cannot tell you what a tremendous honor it is to be here on the quasquabicentennial of the Constitution. If any of you has quasquabicentennial, we can get you a referral to a good physician, because that's pretty bad stuff. So I've told a few people that I was coming to do an address on Constitution Day, and that largely elicited two reactions. The first reaction was, huh? And the second reaction is, what the F is Constitution Day? So I do think it is a very important occasion. It is the birthday of our wonderful Constitution. And in this era, where we read the news or look at news broadcasts and see what other countries do to people who disagree with the prevailing government, it really is amazing that our country has this tremendous document that people, even as politically divergent as they may be, argue about and rarely shoot each other about, and that really is a wonderful thing. I will share with you one other thing. I did actually have to miss an event for Constitution Day of an organization on which I'm a member of the board. Does anybody want to guess the name of the organization that's also having a Constitution Day event? No, it's the Constitution Project. And they too celebrate Constitution Day. It's a wonderful group. It's a wonderful group, and I'll just say 20 seconds about it. It is one of the very few groups in Washington that brings together Republicans and Democrats to try to work on bipartisan solutions to difficult constitutional questions. And we had our board meeting yesterday, and it included, you know, in this group our former congressman, David Keene with the NRA, Judge Sessions, the former director of the FBI, and just a number of other former judges, luminaries. And it is amazing how much agreement there is in that room on a number of important issues, some of which are issues we're going to talk about today, issues like national security and surveillance and the importance of privacy, and how little has been done in Washington on any of those issues in the last several years, although there is some hope on the surveillance issue in light of the board that is looking at those issues. So I thank you very much, and we will begin. The title of today's discussion is Challenges to the Constitution in Our High Technology Era. I hope that the high technology presentation actually works, number one, and number two, doesn't get me arrested. So we have some videos, and we're not going to say exactly where they came from. One topic that I think is perhaps the most important to lead with is the challenge of due process in a dangerous world, and I have a couple of video lead-ins to address that topic.
A controversial spying program managed by the National Security Agency is legal, according to a board appointed by President Obama. The Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board gave their approval to nearly all domestic surveillance and data collection programs they reviewed. Widespread data collection from Americans by the federal government was first revealed in 2013 by NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden. Federal law allows the collection of data from foreigners in other nations when that information crosses the United States. This provision includes the PRISM program, which collects data from social media giants like Facebook, Google, and Apple. The five members of the Privacy Board recommended internal changes in the NSA to prevent abuse of information collected. The panel included two former Justice Department officials, a pair of privacy experts, and a federal judge. They stated some of the programs undertaken by the administration are, quote, close to the line of constitutional reasonableness. Such aspects include the unknown and potentially large scope of the incidental collection of U.S. persons' communications. Section 702 is part of the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. White House lawyers questioned the legality of some programs after George W. Bush expanded domestic spying in the wake of 9/11. Congress legalized the actions in 2008, and Barack Obama, then a senator, voted in favor of the bill. Surveillance of non-Americans living abroad is permitted under the provision without a search warrant. Agencies are also collecting phone numbers and email addresses of those sending and receiving messages. Searches for communications of Americans in the database are generating a fury on Capitol Hill. The U.S. House recently voted to forbid the practice. Use of Section 702 is largely kept classified. There is no public record of how the powers are used or in which cases. Law enforcement agencies will not reveal if they are using the law to investigate other crimes not related to terrorism.
So one question I'd like you all to think about a little bit is, does surveillance challenge our constitutional protections? Surveillance, in one instance or in some instances, can be as great an affront to the rights of privacy that one can conceive of. And I'm not here to talk to you about Supreme Court cases on surveillance, because at least this kind of surveillance hasn't made its way to the high court. There are some lower court challenges that are starting to get underway, and I think there is a tremendous lobbying effort in Washington to curtail some of these surveillance programs. But there are all kinds of manifestations to this, and I don't know how much all of you are aware of. There's plenty of stuff in the public media about what the government is doing. But the bottom line is, and my wife, who Professor LoFaso so charitably described earlier, asked me a question a few days ago, is there any place where people's conversations and thoughts are actually private? And I said, I don't think there is. And she said, well, of course, in the comfort of your own home. And I said, no, not if any of those thoughts are being expressed on your computer, not if you have an open window that a drone could possibly be surveilling. No, because you may have your room bugged, because under a number of these programs, the government can, in certain circumstances, bug people, and it's extremely unclear what the circumstances are. So I said, no, not in your own home. And I think we now live in a society where, whether we want to come to grips with it or not, until there are some new rules promulgated, the idea of a constitutional right to privacy, in many respects, I think, is a facade. And that, I think, is something that you all are going to be dealing with as you enter the practice of law and have to deal with the cases, some dealing with rather mundane personal privacy issues, some perhaps dealing with the most important issues that confront our nation. Because I think that is one of the greatest challenges to our constitutional protections that we have today. And I'm not going to try to tell you which way those issues could come out, because a number of them are very complicated. But I think it's something for you all to be thinking about as you continue in your pursuit of the legal profession. Let's move on to a slightly different but similar topic.
Okay, there are new revelations this morning involving the U.S. drone strikes program. In a 16-page memo obtained by NBC News, the Justice Department makes the legal case for the killing of American citizens overseas if they are believed to be, quote, senior operational leaders of Al-Qaeda or an associated force, even if there is no intelligence indicating they are engaged in an active plot to attack the U.S.
Wow.
Joining us now, NBC News national investigative correspondent Michael Isikoff, who broke the story last night after obtaining the copy of the government memo. Michael, take us through the significance of the memo.
Sure. Good morning, guys. Look, this memo sheds light on what is one of the most controversial and secretive policies of the Obama administration, not just its drone strike campaign, but reserving the right to use drones against American citizens. And this came up in 2011 when a drone strike killed Anwar al-Awlaki and associate in Yemen, Samer Khan. Both were U.S. citizens. Neither had been charged with any crime. So what we have here are what critics call extrajudicial killings, killings ordered by intelligence officials of the U.S. government without any judicial review, without any right of the citizen to argue his or her case in court. So these are very sticky legal issues, and the legal basis for these strikes has been kept a secret by the Obama administration. You may remember we had huge fights back in the Bush era about the legal memos for enhanced interrogation tactics, so the so-called torture memos. Ultimately, they became public. This is viewed by some as an analogy for that. Secret memos upon which huge U.S. government policies with great consequences are being made. We got a copy of this memo, which is not the OLC memo, the Office of Legal Counsel memo, but it is a white paper, 16-page white paper that mirrors and tracks it and gives
Michael,
us much more detail about what's what the legal basis for
Michael,
these strikes are.
One question that I've had to deal with a lot is what process is due to terrorism suspects. I was fortunate enough to be appointed by the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit to represent a man named Adam Hassoun in the Jose Padilla case. Jose Padilla, for those of you who don't remember, was back in the early 2000s, the Bush administration's poster child for success in the war on terror. He was captured at O'Hare Airport and allegedly came to the United States to perform all kinds of varyingly described terrorist acts. At the end of the day, he was not charged with any of those acts, but was charged, along with my client, with allegedly conspiring to recruit people from the United States to go to the Middle East to become members of Al-Qaeda. And my client was convicted and is now serving a 16-year sentence in federal prison for having supposedly recruited Jose Padilla. I won't go into that case in tremendous detail other than to note that the entire prosecution in that case was based on testimony from an FBI agent of alleged coded telephone calls that my client and others made that, if literally translated from Arabic, said things like, "By the will of Allah, it is a beautiful day. Let us go to the market and purchase vegetables." And things like this were said, well, this is, of course, terrorism speak for we're going to acquire anti-aircraft missiles and give them to Saddam. I mean, this is the kind of testimony, all by a guy who didn't speak Arabic, wasn't a code breaker, had no code training, and was working his first terrorism case. But be that as it may, the question of what process is due terrorism suspects, particularly American citizen terrorism suspects, is a very interesting one. And in fact, I just a few weeks ago was part of a program for the American Bar Association that included, you heard in that video clip, the Al-Awlaki case, his lawyer, Phil Hyman, who is the former Deputy Attorney General of the United States, Rachel Brand, who's on the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board, Alex Acosta, who's the former U.S. Attorney in Miami and now the Dean at Florida International University Law School. And by the way, the turnout today is actually even a little better than the turnout was for that program. I really love mandatory attendance. Thank you. Thank you, Dean LaFaso. At that program, we talked about this topic of drone strikes, as well as how that plays in to the current prosecution of Jokhar Tsarnaev, which is going to take place later this year in Boston. And it's a very interesting subject. And the notion that an American citizen could be murdered without any due process at all is one that I think a lot of people would find pretty horrifying. And what the government has done, the Obama administration definitely, and at the end of the Bush administration as well, is taken the position that if we, the government, say this American citizen is a bad person and they are located on foreign soil, they can be executed with no additional process. There was another American Bar Association program a couple of years ago that I chaired where we had former Attorney General Mukasey and former Attorney General Gonzalez both on the panel. And they actually got into a rather interesting disagreement about this, whereas I believe General Mukasey was asked, so where is the due process here? And I believe his response was something to the effect of, they get all the process to which they are due. And the questioner then said, you mean as their body explodes from a drone strike? And his response was, precisely. And General Gonzalez then said, you know, this whole drone stuff started after I left the White House, and I would not have supported it. I don't believe it's legal. I don't believe it's appropriate to murder American citizens without due process. You fast forward to today, and you're going to see in the news in the coming months an awful lot about the Tsarnaev case. And one of the most interesting things about that case is that the government has sought the death penalty. It's an interesting case, not so much because there's a question of guilt or innocence. It seems like there's overwhelming evidence that Tsarnaev did participate in the Boston Marathon bombings. But at the time he did that, he was 19 years old. And he was clearly under the influence of his older brother, who was much more, shall we say, a true believer in the cause than young Jokhar seemed to be at the time. I don't know if any of you here are old enough to remember the Washington, D.C. sniper incident of about 10 years ago, but that was a very similar situation where you had an older man with a younger teenager, I think he was 17 or 18 at the time, who both went around basically just killing random people. The reason for this was because John Muhammad, the older guy, wanted to actually ultimately kill his ex-wife. But he needed to kill everybody else so that he could make it look like the ex-wife was going to be the victim of this random shooting. That was the brilliant plan here. But they killed like 14 people before they quite got to the ex-wife. But Lee Malvo, who was the younger person, was not ultimately prosecuted for the death penalty. And most people thought at the time that was a very wise move by the prosecution. And the main reason was this whole coercion element. And it'll be very interesting to see if that plays a role in the Tsarnaev prosecution. And one of the points that Professor Hyman made in response to that at our program was that what benefit does it give to our society to execute this now 20-year-old individual when it is going to cause a tremendous amount of antagonism in the Islamic world? And he said, and you better believe that if this person is executed, you're going to see terrorists kill 50, 100, 1,000 American citizens in retaliation. Is that really what we want to be doing with our judicial system? So the question isn't just one of what rights do people have, what does the Constitution protect, but it's what signal does it send to the rest of the world when we seem to skirt our own constitutional protections, or at least read them in a way that tends to diminish the rights of our own citizens. Now let's talk a little bit about the Supreme Court. I know a lot of people for Constitution Day talks go through every case at the court and talk about its significance. I'm only going to highlight a few. But I do recommend there are several people who do these great programs going through every decision of the year. Dean Chemerinsky out in California does just a fantastic job with it, and I don't hope to replicate that. But I do think there are some important cases to talk about on this and some of the other topics that I want to discuss. So one way to start this is with another clip. We can get it to play.
Where do you get 100-million-year-old dinosaur blood?
Shh. What? Oh, Mr. DNA, where did you come from?
From your blood. Just one drop of your blood contains billions of strands of DNA, the building blocks of life. A DNA strand, like me, is a blueprint for building a living thing. And sometimes animals that went extinct millions of years ago, like dinosaurs, left their blueprints behind for us to find. We just had to know where to look. 100 million years ago, there were mosquitoes, just like today. And just like today, they fed on the blood of animals, even dinosaurs. Sometimes, after biting a dinosaur, the mosquito would land on the branch of a tree and get stuck in the sap. After a long time, the tree sap would get hard and become fossilized, just like a dinosaur bone, preserving the mosquito inside. This fossilized tree sap, which we call amber, waited for millions of years with the mosquito inside until Jurassic Park scientists came along. Using sophisticated techniques, they extract the preserved blood from the mosquito and, bingo, dino DNA. A full DNA strand contains 3 billion genetic codes. If we looked at screens like these once a second for 8 hours a day, it'd take 2 years to look at the entire DNA strand. It's that long. Since it's so old, it's full of holes. Now that's where our geneticists take over. Thinking machine supercomputers and gene sequencers break down the strand in minutes. And virtual reality displays show our geneticists the gaps in the DNA sequence. We use the complete DNA of a frog to fill in the holes and complete the code. And now we can make a baby dinosaur.
Does anybody know what movie that came from? Okay. DNA. Everybody knows what DNA is, right? Double helix, all that interesting stuff. I don't know how many of you know about Maryland versus King, though. Who's aware of that decision? That's a case that came down 2 terms ago from the Supreme Court. So Maryland versus King is a very interesting case. It held that the Constitution permits the police to take DNA samples from everybody who's arrested. Doesn't matter if you're convicted, doesn't matter if the court or if the police had probable cause. If you are arrested, you get your cheek swabbed under this decision. States have very widely varying rules on what you can do with the DNA. Many states have absolutely no limits whatsoever on what you can do. So some states use it to aid in police investigations. Some states will run your DNA against cold cases to see if there's an unsolved crime that you might be responsible for. Some states sell your DNA to medical labs for research, like the guys at Jurassic Park. A number of folks find this rather disturbing. So one of the things that I'm also involved with is I'm running a project on putting together recommendations for DNA use as part of the work of the Constitution Project. But it is very interesting, I think, that the Supreme Court has said that the police really don't have to have much of an excuse to take your DNA. And many people have advocated a national database with everybody's DNA, regardless of interaction with the criminal justice system. When you're born, your DNA is taken and it's put in a national registry, and your DNA is there for whatever purpose the government or anybody else who gets it wants. Does anybody feel a little uncomfortable about that? What about the notion that the state of California maybe, we're not sure, maybe selling DNA of arrestees to insurance companies so the insurance company can do a genetic analysis of the insured whose DNA they are given to decide if they're going to increase the premiums? Does that sound like a good idea? Anyway, this is yet another issue that I think is going to require a great deal of attention in the next several years as states, police, and in some respects the federal government deal with the implications of this decision going forward. Let's look at another clip. Disappearing cursor.
Bad boys, what you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Bad boys, what you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Bad boys, what you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Bad boys, what you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you?
So let's talk about search and seizure. First of all, United States versus Jones. That is another case from two terms ago. Does anybody know what United States versus Jones is about? It's about affixing a GPS device to your car without you knowing about it. And believe it or not, the government took the position that affixing a GPS device and gathering every piece of data that that GPS device could get, including your movements, there are a number of other things that it can get about you, your whereabouts. Some GPS devices can provide, you know, other kinds of information about your car, et cetera. The government took the position that affixing a GPS device to a car is not a search and therefore has no constitutional implications whatsoever. The Supreme Court disagreed. The court actually said, yes, sticking a GPS device on a car is a search under the Fourth Amendment. However, what the court did not clearly address in the decision was whether such a GPS search always requires a warrant. And there is now, of course, a circuit split among the courts of appeals on that issue. There is also a circuit split on the issue as to whether a search before Jones was decided would be subject to the good faith exception to the Fourth Amendment's exclusionary rule. Right? So the exclusionary rule says that if you, the police, gather evidence in violation of the Constitution, you don't get to submit it in court. But the good faith exception says, well, wait a second, if the officers were acting in good faith, then you don't exclude it from court. And the argument here is that there was allegedly in some places clearly binding precedent that suggested before Jones was decided that these GPS searches were constitutional. The problem is that, and there's a case that our clinic just filed an amicus brief in the Fourth Circuit, that in 2009, the D.C. Circuit decided this case called Maynard, which eventually became Jones in the Supreme Court, and the D.C. Circuit said, you got to be kidding me, of course this is not constitutional. And the case we're involved in is a case after Maynard, where that case had been decided and the government had petitioned for certiorari at the time of the search, whether that search falls within the good faith exception to the exclusionary rule. The Fourth Circuit ruled that the good faith exception did apply. And Judge Shedd wrote a strongly worded opinion saying, you know, the police, it's okay because there were these cases and they sort of said this was okay. Didn't actually discuss that there was a circuit split at the time. I think referred to the Maynard case in a but see site without any explanation. And Judge Thacker, who of course has a a longstanding relationship with this law school, wrote a very persuasive, I thought, and strongly worded dissent. And we got involved in the case and are assisting the counsel for the defendant in that case, Mr. Stevens, and just wrote an amicus brief supporting rehearing en banc in the Fourth Circuit for the National Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers. So it'll be very interesting to see what happens with that in the future. Another case I want to talk a little bit about is Riley versus California. Just as a show of hands, how many of you ever have driven a car? Okay, so the Jones case applies to you. How many of you have a cell phone? All right, so Riley's pretty applicable too. Riley held that police must obtain a warrant before searching content located in cell phone memory, right? The government also took the position that it's a cell phone, it's, you know, plain view, we don't really need a warrant. And the Supreme Court said, no, that's not actually true. It's a, sort of this database, and it's like a computer, and just like you need a warrant to search a computer, you need a warrant to search a cell phone. The court rejected arguments that the possibility of wiping the cell phone remotely. See, this is what happens when the government wants to come up with an extremely limited view of the Constitution. They start coming up with arguments like this. Well, we can't get a warrant for the cell phone because somebody could remotely wipe the cell phone while we're getting the warrant. And that would just be awful, so we have to be able to search these things right away. Court didn't buy that one, and the court emphasized that even suspects in custody have privacy rights. Well, that's sort of reassuring, because the court hasn't actually taken much of a position on that before. And it actually is significant that the court did emphasize that, because at least in the view of many, the government didn't really think that anybody in custody did have their privacy rights. Sorry about that. I can't actually turn off the ringer on my phone because I don't know how to. So, low tech causes an unusual divide. This is not the most significant case, but it's very interesting. It's the Prado Navarrete versus California case, and this case held that anonymous 911 calls can create probable cause for a warrantless Terry stop for a vehicle allegedly fleeing the scene of criminal activity. And what happened here was there was some dude, nobody knows who because the dude was anonymous, calls the police and says, I just got run off the road by this lunatic truck. And, you know, I could have sworn that before, I guess he was at a stop previously with the truck, and I could have sworn I saw drugs being loaded onto the truck. And this guy just ran me off the road and ran me off the road like 18 minutes ago. And the police were somehow able to verify that this call came from a car located exactly 19 miles from where the supposed running off the road happened. And because of this, the police argued, well, you know, this was pretty reliable because some guy said they got run off the road. It looks like they would have traveled about the right distance and the right time frame to make this call. And so even though it's anonymous, we're going to stop this vehicle. And Terry stops, you don't need a warrant, right? If you have probable cause to believe that this is a vehicle or a person fleeing from the scene of criminal activity, you can actually stop them without a warrant. And the question was, does this anonymous 911 call do that? The court said yes. Justice Thomas delivered the decision for a split 5-4 court, holding that at least in some circumstances, this is sufficiently reliable for a warrantless stop and search. Justice Scalia, right, Justice Thomas's best buddy, right, they almost never disagree on cases, wrote a scathing dissent, as he almost always does in cases where he dissents, proclaiming the ruling serves up a freedom-destroying cocktail consisting of two parts patent falsity. And Justice Scalia's point was, are you kidding me? Anonymous 911 calls, that's going to get you a warrantless stop? There's no indicia of reliability. There could be any joker calling for any reason. And yes, one fact is corroborated, the supposed distance thing, and that's enough. And he goes on to this parade of horribles and say this could allow the government basically to do unlimited Terry stops whenever they want, and we can't have that, and here's where we have to draw the line. But the court majority didn't agree with that. So it was a very interesting and somewhat unusual split on the court. All right, let's move to another topic.
The department was forced to drop the charges. Because you forgot to read him his Miranda rights.
I did read him his rights. I did a version of that.
Do you even know the Miranda rights?
Yes.
Let's hear them then.
Look, it obviously starts with you have the right to remain silent. I know you've heard this before. And then, I think it sounds something like, do you have the right to remain an attorney?
Did you say that you have the right to be an attorney?
You do have the right to be an attorney if you want to.
So there's lots of rights. There's one more clip that's going to focus on one piece of the rights that I want to talk about.
On May 14th, the Treasury Inspector General released a report finding that the exempt organization's field office in Cincinnati, Ohio, used inappropriate criteria to identify for further review applications from organizations that plan to engage in political activity, which may mean that they did not qualify for tax exemption. On that same day, the Department of Justice launched an investigation into the matters described in the Inspector General's report. In addition, members of this committee have accused me of providing false information when I responded to questions about the IRS processing of applications for tax exemption. I have not done anything wrong. I have not broken any laws. I have not violated any IRS rules or regulations, and I have not provided false information to this or any other congressional committee. And while I would very much like to answer the committee's questions today, I've been advised by my counsel to assert my constitutional right not to testify or answer questions related to the subject matter of this hearing. After very careful consideration, I've decided to follow my counsel's advice and not testify or answer any of the questions today. Because I'm asserting my right not to testify, I know that some people will assume that I've done something wrong. I have not. One of the basic functions of the Fifth Amendment is to protect innocent individuals, and that is the protection I'm invoking today. Thank you.
Taking the Fifth. Couple of very interesting cases on the Fifth Amendment this past term that are worth talking about. The first is Kansas versus Cheever. The court in that case said that the Fifth Amendment does not apply to death penalty cases to protect against testimony against a defendant from a government psychiatrist after an involuntary examination. And this is kind of a weird case where there were parallel state and federal prosecutions. The defense wanted to argue that the defendant was so intoxicated on meth that he didn't appreciate right from wrong at the time he murdered the individual who was murdered. And in doing so, proffered testimony from an expert. And while the government had a federal case pending, the government required this guy to undergo a psychiatric exam by a government expert. And in doing that, said things that the government contended helped their argument that this guy shouldn't be excused because of his meth intoxication. The federal case then gets dismissed, and he gets prosecuted for murder in a state case. And in the state prosecution enters, has testimony from the federal government psychiatrist saying basically, you know, whatever this guy's saying is wrong. And this guy says, wait a second, stuff I told a psychiatrist in a coerced, compelled government examination is not allowed to be introduced against me because it's my own words, you know, being used against me under the Fifth Amendment. And the court in this case said, well, in the normal course, that's probably right, but because you introduced evidence of this supposed mental incompetence, the government was allowed to use evidence from a compulsory exam to rebut that. And so this is admittedly a somewhat unusual circumstance, but nonetheless a potentially significant erosion of Fifth Amendment rights, because I think before this case, it had largely been considered the rule that only in very rare circumstances could evidence from a compulsory exam or a non-consensual government process where the defendant made statements be used against the defendant, and this seems to erode that fairly significantly. Another Fifth Amendment case that was interesting is White versus Woodall, and that was a habeas case. And as many of you may know, the standards for relief on habeas, does everybody know what habeas is? Okay. So basically, habeas is a writ that allows you to be released from custody where you believe that you are wrongfully in custody or in prison. And the way it plays out in a number of these constitutional cases is there is a state prosecution. Somebody's convicted, they go through the state appeals process, and the conviction's upheld. And then they bring a case either in state court under state habeas or in federal court under federal habeas saying that there was a constitutional defect in the way I was prosecuted or in the evidence against me. But the standards for getting federal relief on habeas are pretty onerous. It's a lot harder to get relief than it might be if, say, there was a direct appeal. And so here, there was the question was the age-old Fifth Amendment core question. What is the jury told when the defendant decides not to testify? And the defense said, in this case, I think it was from Kansas, said the trial court absolutely needed to give an instruction that the jury could draw no adverse inference from the defendant's failure to testify. And the state trial court said, no, I'm not giving that instruction, and gave a much less significant instruction. You can't blame the defendant for not testifying in some circumstances, something like that. The Supreme Court said, at least for habeas, the standard is not whether they're right or wrong. The standard is whether there was some basis for the state court to rule the way it did, such that it was not an unreasonable application of prior Supreme Court precedent. And the court said our prior precedent is not crystal clear that you would have to have no adverse inference instruction if you asked for it. And then the court said, now, of course, we're not actually answering the question whether that's right or wrong as a matter of law, and it might be different if this were a direct appeal from a criminal conviction in federal court. But on habeas, we're not going to answer the question about whether it's right or wrong. We're just going to say that it wasn't so wrong that we're going to grant relief on federal habeas. And another sort of, you know, slight diminution of Fifth Amendment protections, because the one thing I think most criminal defense lawyers would say is the only thing that's absolutely sacrosanct in a criminal proceeding is your no adverse inference instruction. And if you're not getting that, you're kind of, you know, in deep trouble as a criminal defendant if you don't testify. So those are two cases that perhaps, you know, aren't squarely as undermining the Fifth Amendment as one might think, but actually I think do tend to hamper the Fifth Amendment fairly significantly. On the other hand, there were some death penalty victories this past term for the defense, which again isn't all that common necessarily with the current court. The first case is Hinton versus Alabama, and this is a case where the court held that a defendant whose counsel didn't understand that he was allowed to spend a significant amount of money to get a defense expert. This was appointed defense counsel, and in Alabama, you can spend money on a defense expert and get reimbursed for that. He thought there was a $1,000 limit, and the only evidence in the case was ballistics evidence that it was the defendant's gun that killed the victim. No eyewitness evidence, no fingerprints, nothing, just the ballistics evidence. And the defense wanted to hire a counter expert to say that the ballistics analysis done by the prosecution's expert was crappy and didn't prove anything. But the guy thought he only had $1,000. So he basically went to some gun show and said, hey, anybody who want to testify for me in this case gets $1,000. And the first guy, well, he didn't actually do that, but he you can't really get much expert, you can't really hire an expert for $1,000 and expect anybody who knows anything to actually do it for that. And so the expert was inadequate. And then in post-trial proceedings, I think there was new counsel that was pro bono, and they spent a lot of money and actually got really good ballistics experts to say and convincingly submit affidavits that the prosecution's ballistics evidence was terrible and that there's no evidence that this gun actually killed this guy, and therefore no evidence that, that Mr. Hinton was the murderer. And so the court said, you know what, that's right, and said that, that Hinton had been provided ineffective assistance of counsel and remanded for further proceedings, which one would think will include a new trial. Another case where the defense won is Hall versus Florida. This is another area of law that I've been involved with because we had a pro bono case a number of years ago on the same issue. So Florida had this rule that said, okay, if you're mentally disabled, we can't execute you. And we're going to decide that you're mentally disabled if your IQ is 70 or lower. But if it's 71, and the court said, you know, the 70 threshold seems somewhat arbitrary, and at minimum, somebody on who may be facing the death penalty should be able to provide a complete case that, that he or she is mentally disabled. And so the court said, and this guy also had IQ scores ranging anywhere from 60 to 80, and they threw out on an evidentiary matter the ones below 70, and then they included in evidence the ones that were 71 and higher, and said, since it's 71 at least, it's okay to execute this guy. And the court said, nice try, but that's not going to be the rule that we adopt. So, you know, two victories in the death penalty. And we're going to have a clip here that talks about a subject that often comes with the subject of death.
Assault, arrest, resisting arrest.
We got a collection agent for the mob. Two of these guys have done serious time.
Look, they're the best at what they do.
So am I. And I'm not so optimistic. We spend $250 billion a year on defense. And here we are. The fate of the planet is in the hands of a bunch of retards I wouldn't trust with a potato gun.
So what's the verdict?
They'll do it. They've made a few requests, though.
Such as?
Well, there's a few things here. Nothing really big. As an example, Oscar here has got some outstanding parking tickets. Wants them wiped off his record.
56 tickets in 7 states.
I'll tell him, Oscar. Got it.
Okay.
Noonan's got 2 women friends that he'd like to see made American citizens, no questions asked. Max would like you to bring back 8-track tapes. Not sure if that's going to work, but let's see what else. Chick wants a full week's Emperor's package at Caesar's Palace. Hey, you guys wouldn't be able to tell us who actually killed Kennedy, would you? Bear would like to stay at the White Horse.
White House. White House.
White House. Yeah, he'd like to stay in the Lincoln bedroom of the White House for the summer. Stuff like that.
Sure, I think we can take care of some of that.
Harry.
Yeah, one more thing. None of them want to pay taxes again. Ever.
Taxes. So there's a case that is pending now that is near and dear to my own heart, Controller versus Wynn. And this is a case coming from the Maryland Court of Appeals. Has anybody here heard of the Negative Commerce Clause? Right? Okay, so you know what the Commerce Clause is, right? So there's a Commerce Clause that talks about regulation of interstate commerce and only the federal government can do it. All right. Well, the Negative Commerce Clause is it's really the negative implication of the Commerce Clause. A state is not allowed to inequitably burden commerce that takes place in another state. And so in the income tax area, that has always generally meant that if you earn income in multiple states and you pay income tax in one state that isn't your home state, you can offset your home state income tax by that amount. So for those of us who work at, you know, institutions like law firms that pay taxes in like 30 different states, income that I earn that's attributed to California, I pay in California, but that gets offset against my Maryland income tax. But Maryland had a neat little invention. They have split their state tax into a state component and a county component. So if you live in Maryland, you pay tax, your state component, but you also pay your county component. And it differs by the county. Now, I live in Montgomery County, Maryland, which, of course, is the highest county component in the state. The Maryland Court of Appeals had decided that it was okay, or actually, sorry, the lower court in Maryland had decided that it was okay to offset income from another state against only that state Maryland component, but not the county component. So if you had a lot of income out of state, such that your entire in-state component was accounted for and offset, then you couldn't get any more offset because you had to pay the full county component no matter what out-of-state income you got. The Maryland Court of Appeals said, wait a second, we can't do that because that's unconstitutional, because that burdens out-of-state income greater than in-state income. Seemed pretty straightforward. My accountant was jumping for joy. Oh, this is great. Made me spend thousands of dollars to refile returns for several recent years. Good times. But then the Supreme Court decided to take cert on this. And now the state's position is that, well, county taxes directly support county services, like the wonderful road crews that never come out to fix the potholes in our county. So you're getting all of those services, so we can't offset that. And, of course, you know, that could be said about any state service. So it'll be very interesting to see what the court does. The Obama administration weighed in this case, supporting Maryland and saying, yeah, they're fine. They can not offset any of the county tax, and that's just all fine and dandy. Don't worry about it. So it'll be very interesting to see what happens. I'm actually going to skip this clip because we're running a little bit late on time. It's just a clip about the Town of Greece case. I want to talk a little bit about everybody's favorite subject, religion. The Town of Greece case came up, and the question was, could you start your county board meetings with a prayer to God? Not which God, no name for God, just some God concept. And whether that's okay under the Establishment Clause. And the challengers said, well, maybe in some circumstances you can, but the themes of these prayers were more Christian-based, and that violated the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment because you were favoring Christianity over other religions. And the court relied on a pretty well-known Establishment Clause precedent, Marsh versus Chambers, which had said that legislatures can begin their sessions with prayers as long as they're relatively non-denominational and you don't force people to participate. And in this case, the court reasoned that, well, I mean, some dudes just, you know, starting with a prayer, they're not requiring people to participate. It's you know, they thought it was harmless enough, and so they said that it, as they had in Marsh, there is a tradition of beginning official public meetings with some kind of prayer, and if it's not coercive, it's okay. And this coercion test is very interesting for those of you who are interested in the Establishment Clause. There was a case that was decided quite a while ago called Lemon versus Kurtzman that had a whole analysis for where the Establishment Clause was violated. And in a series of decisions in the early 90s, that test was sort of cabined a little bit. Justice O'Connor had a sort of an endorsement test that if government exercise of religion appeared to endorse a particular religion or endorse religion over non-religion, it violated the Establishment Clause. In those cases in the early 90s, Justice Kennedy either concurred or dissented and said, no, really the test is coercion. The government can endorse religion, it just can't coerce you to participate in a religious exercise. And the only real significance of the Town of Greece case is it looks that, you know, now that Justice O'Connor is somewhat long gone from the court, that the coercion test has ultimately replaced Lemon as really the test for the Establishment Clause, as many people had predicted, but those who thought that perhaps the coercion test doesn't protect against government religious expression enough aren't too happy about. Another religion case that I want to talk about briefly is the Barwell versus Hobby Lobby case. This is not controversial at all. This is the least controversial. So the court held that under the First Amendment and the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, under the Affordable Health Care Act, for those of you who know it as Obamacare, that's the statute, there are these exemptions from the requirement that a health plan provide coverage for contraception, right? And so religious institutions are exempted. I believe employers who have less than 50 employees are exempted, and nonprofit corporations are exempted. And so these for-profit corporations with more than 50 people brought a challenge and said, hey, we don't want our company to pay for contraception because that offends our religious beliefs. And the government said, no, we sort of specified what the exceptions are, and you're a for-profit company, you don't have religious beliefs. The Supreme Court said, well, wait a second, you've exempted nonprofits, right? So if you're defining the term persons in the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, it's pretty hard to say that nonprofits are persons, but that for-profits aren't. That's a distinction that doesn't make any sense. So we think that a for-profit corporation is a person. And then the court basically said that, and moreover, corporations have rights to freedom of religion. And they can exercise their free exercise rights. They have, they're not just a person for the statute, they're a person for the Constitution in the sense that they have free exercise rights. And so on that basis, the court said you have to allow an exemption for these for-profit corporations that don't want to pay for contraception. Now, the court did say there are a lot of alternatives. You can do this to a plan. You can have an add-on where the corporation doesn't pay for the contraception, but the individual does. And it tried to suggest this is no really big deal because we're not saying the corporation can't provide any possibility of a health plan that provides contraception. The corporation just doesn't have to pay for it. How that all shakes out in practice remains to be seen. And this sort of reminds me of another story about my wife, who did her medical training at Georgetown University Hospital and is now the associate dean there. Suffice it to say that when she was a resident there, she wrote an awful lot of prescriptions to women for acne medicine because contraception was not allowed to be prescribed. But as you know, you probably know many contraceptives also work against acne. So there are a lot of acne prescriptions. How this is going to work out in practice, we'll see. Another case that I want to talk about very briefly is McCullen versus Coakley. This is not on the subject of religion, but on the subject of abortion. And this is a First Amendment buffer case. So there is a doctrine under the First Amendment that deals with what government restrictions can occur in public fora. And they include things like parks. Well, this was a case about public sidewalks. And can a state say that you cannot be within, on a public sidewalk, and loiter within 35 feet of a non-hospital that provides abortion services? And the Massachusetts legislature, you know, instituted this 35-foot buffer zone. The Supreme Court said that was unconstitutional. And it said because this is a public forum, the law wasn't sufficiently narrowly tailored to pass constitutional muster. It said that this is, you know, sort of it's not a strict scrutiny case. It's a case where we just look at whether the restrictions are narrowly tailored to fulfill a legitimate government purpose. And they said this 35-foot blanket rule wasn't. They left all kinds of room for perhaps less restrictive means to allow people to enter abortion clinics without basically running into a wall of protesters, but they said this law doesn't do it. And it was very clear, I think, at least I thought in the case, that this was limited to the public sidewalks, not to, for example, land or a path that's actually on the clinic's premises. If it's not a public sidewalk, if there's a path, you know, an entry walk, it wouldn't cover that. If the public sidewalk were, you know, far away, but there was closer land, it wouldn't cover the closer land. So that may be a fairly narrow ruling, but nonetheless was considered pretty controversial. And we're almost done. I know the time has run a little over. I just want to talk about two other quickly significant cases. The first is the shoot versus bomb case. And this is an equal protection case dealing with university admissions, which may be a subject near and dear to some of your hearts. This case, in Michigan, there was a statewide referendum that prohibits state universities from considering race as a factor in admissions. The court was extremely divided in this decision, and Justice Kagan didn't participate. So you had 8 justices and a total of 5 opinions. And writing for 3 judges, Justice Kennedy said that the Michigan referendum should be upheld, but emphasized that the case was not about the constitutional permissibility of race-based considerations in university admissions, but only about whether voter initiatives to specifically restrict states from doing race-based consideration were themselves constitutional, and tried to distinguish between cases saying a state can't consider these under the Constitution and cases where there's a voter referendum saying we don't want the state to consider them. Made that distinction and said in that circumstance it was okay. But the court's still kind of a mess on this issue, as they've been for many years, and it'll be interesting to see how it all turns out. And then the last case I want to talk about is a case that my firm handled, NLRB versus Noel Canning. That's a case in which the court held that the Constitution's Recess Appointments Clause — has anybody ever heard of the Recess Appointments Clause before this? A few people. It does not apply to recess at schools. Nothing to do with monkey bars, or it has to do with appointing government officials during a period in which Congress is in recess. And let me tell you, Congress doesn't swing on the monkey bars, but they do a whole lot worse when they're in recess. So there was this 3-day congressional adjournment, right? So it's like a long weekend. And during this long weekend, President Obama decides, I'm going to appoint several board members to the NLRB because I can't get them through otherwise. The court in this case did not clearly set forth a rule as to how long a recess can trigger the Recess Appointments Clause, but it did rule that you can't do it in a 3-day adjournment, that that's not a recess for purposes of appointing government officials that otherwise would have to be appointed with the advice and consent of the Senate, because most government officials at a high enough level have to have Senate approval, and this circumvented that. And a three-day adjournment doesn't do it. Whether it's, you know, the recess for the summer, or it's got to be a month long, or it's got to be 2 weeks, no one knows, but 3 days doesn't cut it. But I believe that there were a number of NLRB decisions that were issued with the board members who were appointed during the 3-day recess, and that there arguably all of those decisions will get invalidated and have to get re-adjudicated with newly nominated and approved members of the NLRB. And very interesting, the lawyer, my colleague, who represented Noel Canning, his name is Noel. And that seems really weird. So I thought I would mention that. So I think those are a good sampling of the cases dealing with constitutional issues. As I said, I think there are a lot of threats out there to the Constitution in surveillance, how we treat terrorism suspects, privacy issues. We saw that in some criminal law issues, the court has been more protective of liberty, but in other areas, particularly in the Fifth Amendment area, perhaps a little bit less protective. You saw that in the First Amendment area, there were some interesting cases, and in some of these very controversial issues, some very divided cases. So I think that's a good place for the state of the Constitution. I know that this was allegedly supposed to end at around 5, but I'd like to take at least some time for questions if people have questions, and I thank you for your attention. Any questions? Yeah, childcare definitely. If you have to go to the bathroom, you got to stay. But we will give you a container to use. Any questions? Questions? Yeah.
Larry, I just wanted to ask you a little bit more about your take on the Town of Greece case. Now, I read it when it came out. I haven't looked back at it.
Yeah.
In your circles, are people talking about this as sort of signaling the death of Lemon? Because I read it more narrowly than that. I mean, the Marsh versus Chambers thing has always been kind of a separate body of cases.
Yeah.
And they took an approach to that case different from the ones some of the lower courts have been taking, where they were just parsing, is the prayer sectarian or not? But I didn't, and I mean, you're right that Kennedy being the median justice makes a difference. You're right, as you tried to do the coercion test, but I don't think they've quite gotten there yet. Do people in your circles view it differently?
I think nobody's 100% sure. I think it's a fair point. I think that the view that most people have, that I work with, you know, which includes people like at the ACLU and whatever, think that the death, Lemon died a long time ago, and that O'Connor basically trumped it with the endorsement test, right. And people could live with
which
that.
Which Kennedy hates.
Right. And particularly in school, you know, prayer cases, the endorsement test has always really been the test, but Kennedy's always tried to push it toward coercion. And I think the view is, at least a lot of people's view had been, once O'Connor was gone, bye-bye endorsement, hello coercion. And while you're absolutely right, I mean, Greece directly stems from Marsh and can be cabined as a very different issue, I worry that this really signals that coercion is the test. And I think that's fine in legislative prayer cases. That doesn't bother me, and I don't think it bothers too many people. It wasn't like a big deal case that people were up in arms about because of the holding. But I just think it looks sort of below the surface like this shows that coercion may be taking hold. And I think in the school prayer situation, it's difficult, because if you have a school prayer situation where you have school-endorsed prayers, even if they're arguably not coercive because nobody has to participate, they're de facto coercive because in a public school environment, peer pressure is going to coerce. And I don't think Kennedy's quite gotten that yet in his jurisprudence. I don't think he's fully accepted.
Well, but he wrote Weissman, right? And I mean, Weissman adopts a pretty expansive approach,
yes,
of what counts as coercion.
Right, but the view was that Weissman was part of this great deal that was made between O'Connor and Kennedy on a variety of issues, including abortion, at the time, and that Kennedy never really believed in endorsement. And yes, that was the rule in Weissman, but the feeling is that given his druthers, Kennedy's going to shift to coercion. So we'll see. I mean, you don't know for sure, and I'm just giving my not completely educated opinion on it, but I think it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Hello, thank you for coming today. It's been I've enjoyed your presentation quite a lot.
Thanks.
I just have a question about, my name's Brad. I'm a first-year law student here. I have a question about the comment you made earlier about not seeking the death penalty for the younger of the two Boston Marathon terror suspects.
Mm-hmm.
To what extent do you feel we should comply with the perceived threats by terrorist organizations in prosecuting those individuals? Suppose tomorrow they say, well, if you prosecute them to any extent, we're going to retaliate. Where do we draw the line with that? And that's a question that has a...
that's a policy question, but I'll give it a shot.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think anybody's suggesting that we should bow to terrorist pressure on that. Right. But as far as I know, nobody has said, if you execute Tsarnaev, we'll do X. But as a matter of reality in the world, that's what is likely to happen. And I think that prosecutors do have a duty to consider the implications of a prosecution on the community, and in the case of a case with national implications on the country. And so I do think it's something that prosecutors do need to consider. What I was trying to do was repeat, I think, Professor Hyman's comment on it, that he felt it was extremely ill-advised to seek the death penalty in that case, given the circumstances and given the almost certain implications and repercussions it's likely to have internationally. And I think part of that is to try to put the United States in the position as a world leader in protecting the rights of the accused. And it's pretty questionable, I think, in any circumstances, to invoke the death penalty for somebody who is relatively young. I obviously, we haven't made that distinction. There's plenty of scientific literature out there that the human brain doesn't fully develop into adulthood, no offense to anybody here, until the age of 25. And so a 19-year-old brain is not fully developed as an adult brain. And when that kind of a person particularly is being led by the snout, basically, by the older brother, right, who has been training and meeting with all kinds of subversive folks, which, by the way, the federal government knew a lot about and still decided not to pick him up. And I mean, there's all kinds of interesting things about the failure of the government in that circumstance to investigate the Tsarnaev boys before the Boston Marathon thing happened, because they questioned the older brother and just not uncovered all of this, or at least not considered important all of this evidence that this guy was a pretty bad guy. Your point's a good one. You can't sort of, you know, as a nation say we're going to bow to terrorism. But at the on the other hand, you know, a questionable prosecution decision that could have international implications and implications for the lives of a lot of Americans, I think is something that should be done very carefully and seriously.
Thank you.
But good question. Any other questions?
Hi, my name is Matthew Conliffe. Quick question on the PCLOB 702 decision or advice that they came out with.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I read it, and I was a little disturbed by the fact that they just kind of like said, okay, it's all good. But knowing about it, it's not actually that bad. But the fact that there's no adversarial process, and they didn't really ask for an adversarial process with the FISC.
Yeah.
What is the general opinion on that?
Well, it's interesting because in this board meeting I was in yesterday, one of the things that a number of pro civil liberties groups and privacy groups are now really trying to push on the Hill is that any time there is a serious question about gathering information under 702, that the FISA court or whatever body is ultimately involved, whatever government agency, must appoint a privacy and civil liberties advocate to present the position of everybody, you know, of the citizens, in light of whatever they're thinking of doing to change the rules. This has not been adopted by Congress or anyone yet, but that is something that they're really trying to push, which is not to necessarily make it an adversary process, but at least appoint somebody who has the interests of the public and people who are being targeted for surveillance or other issues under the laws to advocate on their behalf when the government is considering either taking a broad policy position that isn't done, you know, by Congress, but is done through executive action, or if they are targeting specific individuals, such as in a FISA court setting, appointing somebody to be their advocate in the FISA court. So we'll see. We'll see what happens, but it's an interesting position. It is very difficult to protect due process without any kind of adversary proceeding, or at least somebody representing the interests of the people whose rights might be abridged. Just very, very difficult to do it. Thanks. Other questions? Comments? Right, so I'll conclude with the story that Professor LoFaso started very briefly. So she's right that my roommate in law school, who was very close to this Professor Burbank at Penn, had said he really likes it when you challenge him. And I did read the professor's article on the Rules Enabling Act, which was pretty well written, but I thought he was wrong about several things. So I went up to him after class. It was either the first or second day. I think it was the first day, and said, you know, I read your article. I'd love to discuss it with you sometime. I thought it was well done. But here are about eight things that I thought were wrong with it, and I just listed them. And he looked at me, and with each additional point I made, his face went from neutral to upset. And then after this, which it probably took just a few minutes, he said, thank you so much for your opinion. I will carefully consider everything you have said. And I look forward to seeing you in class tomorrow, Mr. Rosenberg. So I get to class the next day, and he greets the class. Good morning, class. Mr. Rosenberg, it's so good to see you this morning. I said, it's good to see you too, Professor. He said, Mr. Rosenberg, let's talk for a while about the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, shall we? I said, of course. So he starts by saying, let's talk about Rule 12. Can you count to 12, Mr. Rosenberg? I said, yes, in fact, I can, Professor. Let's talk about Rule 12. And he says something to the effect of, you know, and what does Rule 12 establish? And I gave some answer, and I included the words prima facie, saying that if you fail to meet the prima facie requirements of a cause of action, you may be subject to dismissal under various provisions of Rule 12, such as 12b1 for lack of jurisdiction or 12b6 for lack of stating a claim. And he goes, prima facie, Mr. Rosenberg? Is that Latin? I said, yes, it is, Professor Burbeck, as well you should know since you delivered your valedictory at Harvard in Latin. He goes, fair enough. And then he says, and then he starts going on to various other points. And we wind up talking about contributory negligence and how that goes into something. And he sort of says, and so can you give me an example of where contributory negligence might be an issue? And I said, well, if there's a car accident and the car in front of you was operating in an unsafe manner, but at the time that person hit the brakes, the fuzzy dice you have hanging from your rearview mirror hits you in the head. He goes, fuzzy dice, Mr. Rosenberg? Is that what happened to you? Because that would explain an awful lot. Thanks very much.
I knew that Larry would tell that story much better than I would. He's much funnier than I am. He's also a lot smarter than I am. You can tell, I mean, he put this together yesterday, and a person cannot put together something as well done, as cogently argued, as crystal clear as that presentation without really have been doing this for many, many years at a high level. And this is what we all aspire to as lawyers, is to be excellent. And so we cannot possibly thank Larry for everything he does for us here, including that he takes no salary for his work here as a professor in the clinic. And we have world-class clinics here under Marjorie McDermott's direction, and many of them do not work for very much, including Larry. And so we just so greatly appreciate everything he does. We have a small token of our appreciation here. And just want to say thank you so much, Larry.
Thank you very
really
much.
Appreciate really everything. Appreciate it.
Thank you all for coming. Really appreciate it. We'll be around for a little bit if other people have, you know, questions they want to come up with. But I also have my class in a few minutes. But thank you all very much. Appreciate it.